You're listening to the audio production of Your Prophetic Life Map, a guide to a God-crafted life by Steve Witt, published by Thomas Nelson and read by Tom Parks. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit thomasnelson.com/p/prophetic-life-audio. I wrote this book with several extraordinary people in mind. My children, Megan, Lauren, Ashley, Joshua, and spouses. Also to an emerging generation of amazing grandchildren, Moses, Josephine, Maxwell, Madeline, and the others to come. Set the world on fire. To my Canadian wife of more than 40 years, Cindy, you've lived this in fullness. Foreword. Your Prophetic Life Map is an extremely timely book for the people of God. Most of us struggle with understanding our role in seeing the fulfillment of the promises of God for our lives. Some wait and do nothing, stating that their job is to stand by and see the salvation of the Lord, which He will accomplish for you today. This is a very legitimate posture for the believer to take, as it's in the Bible. And yet others will state, "The kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent take it by force." That group will point to the fact that faith needs an action, and sometimes that action involves spiritual warfare. This is also a legitimate position to take, as Jesus taught His disciples about this in Mark chapter 10. Confusion over our role is what often sours the journey of the average believer. I believe that what God has given my friend and author Steve Witt will help add clarity to this vital subject, as we are on a relational journey. I prefer the outcome where promises, destinies, and impact on the world around us become more fully realized. But Jesus likes the journey whereby we become a people who can live in the glory for which we were created. If fulfilled promises were all that this book brought into our lives, it would be worth its weight in gold. But the author goes far beyond the subject of fulfillment, making this book priceless. Most of us pour our lives out for the Lord that we might see the great impact of our devotion to Christ. We desire His power flowing through us in a way that confronts the impossible, bringing it under influence of the one who knows no impossibilities. Simply put, many of us are focused on the outcome. And while Your Prophetic Life Map satisfies that need, its primary focus is profound in that it is focused on the journey and not just the destination. In the journey, Jesus put His attention on what we are becoming. I have felt for many years that the measure of the will of God we get to enjoy in this life is often determined by our maturity. Picture it this way. The will of God is glorious and wonderful, on earth as it is in heaven. But it is also weighty, carrying with it greater and greater responsibilities. The character of many in history couldn't carry the weight involved in the level of miracles surrounding their lives. There were cracks in their foundations that were almost unnoticeable when little was happening. But those character flaws became all too obvious under the weight of the greater glory. And yet we know that God's intent is that the reality of His world would influence and shape this one. Here is the beauty of what this author does for each of us. He draws us into the book because of our God-given hunger for fulfillment. But then he works to build in us a substantial foundation that will hold under the increasing weight of what God intends to do in and through our lives. Remember, transformed people transform nations. This is His heart, to have a people who represent Jesus well in purity and power. It is this group who will help to fulfill the mandate to disciple nations. The bottom line is that this book helps us to be joyfully engaged in the process, not just the outcome. One of the things that makes this book so rich is that it was born out of a life lived in absolute surrender to Jesus. Because of this, you won't find theories and religious rhetoric that are used to fill the weak places in so many books. These insights were given to one of the most trusted men I know, Steve Witt. He has been a personal strength and inspiration to me for many years. The lessons learned in a war are not soon forgotten. That is the reality of this book. Your prophetic life map is very practical, inspirational, and prophetic. My prayer is that the word of the Lord that is spoken over your life would come to the surface while listening to this book. May these words prompt you to ask the challenging questions about the direction and purpose of your life. And in the process, may extraordinary courage be your portion to see everything come to pass that God has spoken. Bill Johnson, Bethel Church, Redding, California, author of The Way of Life and Raising Giant Killers. Introduction. If you've ever tried to learn a foreign language, then you know the process requires more than just memorizing vocabulary and parroting speech. Fluency in a new language requires an understanding of the culture from those who regularly speak it. You need to keep in mind certain customs, quirks, and habits. You have to glimpse the beauty, mystery, and music of the culture in order to speak the language and understand its cadence, rhythm, and tempo. This book is about learning a new language. We will explore what's usually called prophetic faith. Followers of Jesus who speak about the prophetic are typically referring to a personal experience in which they encounter and attempt to understand messages from God. The word prophecy comes from the Greek and literally means a discourse emanating from divine inspiration and declaring the purpose of God. In other words, it's communication from God to you, conveying direction or clarification about your life or future events. This practice makes some people uncomfortable. Many of them don't fully understand or trust the meaning of what's called prophetic in the church. This has created a fear of hearing, understanding, and responding to the voice of God. While admittedly many squirrely things can happen in the name of hearing from God, it doesn't mean we can't talk to Him and hear from Him. After all, that's what prayer is all about, a conversation with the Lord. If we're not talking to God and listening to Him, it makes it hard to know all that He wants us to know. It makes it even tougher to live by faith. Consider how frustrating it would be to communicate with someone if you weren't willing to at least try to speak their language, especially if they were trying to give you directions to your destination. From the beginning, our Creator's desire was to know us as His children and be known. When Adam and Eve freely chose to disobey God, their rebellion created a separation that was restored in the person of Jesus Christ. He opened the gateway of understanding and clarity. The Bible says that the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. Revelation chapter 19, verse 10, NIV. All the things you need to know about God are revealed in your relationship with Jesus. And Jesus wants us to understand. His parables were crafted for the hungry and discerning. Nonetheless, His disciples often struggled to grasp what Jesus was really talking about. It took intention, reflection, and discernment to learn the language of heaven. For us today, it also requires the Holy Spirit's guidance. On the day of Pentecost, when the Spirit descended and ignited God's presence in His followers, how we can know and communicate with God forever changed. Peter described this fiery explosion of God's power descending as the fulfillment of the ancient prophecy we find in Joel chapter 2. The gift of the Spirit provides us with an anointing of revelation, an awareness of heaven on earth. At Pentecost, it was as if heaven had been punctured so that spiritual gifts suddenly poured out on those seeking God. Peter said this promise they had received was intended for them, their children, and all who were afar off. Acts chapter 2, verse 39, NIV. Consequently, we know today that Holy Spirit-led people are still prophetic. Scripture explains that through the Holy Spirit, God will show you the future, reveal secrets, and unveil your purpose. From this impartment, God will also give you new life, victory, purification, and encouragement. Your prophetic gift will reveal things that bring amazement, provoke criticism, and facilitate transformation. These were certainly the results in the early church, where prophecy ranked as a high priority among believers. In his letter to the Corinthians, Paul explained how prophecy is a gift of the Holy Spirit that allows us to speak to others for their strengthening, encouraging, and comfort. 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 3, NIV. He went on to stress, "I would like every one of you to speak in tongues, but I would rather have you prophesy." Verse 5, NIV. If the prophetic is a journey of discovering what God thinks and says about you, then the Bible is your compass. Scripture provides direction and orientation for understanding what it means to know God and the history of His people. In God's Word, we encounter the gift of His Son, Jesus, who was born a baby, lived as a man, and died as a sacrifice for our sins, only to rise again as our Savior. After revealing Himself to His followers as the risen Christ, Jesus ascended to heaven and sent the gift of the Holy Spirit to us. Throughout my life, I have experienced the power of a relationship with the Holy Spirit. I'm convinced God shares His Spirit as our guide on the adventure of faith to which we're all invited. I've noticed over my years of experiencing the prophetic heart of God that more truth is realized in the deepest, most intimate places of our relationship with Him. As you pursue a closer relationship with God, you are privy to His prophetic wisdom. You see, your proximity matters, and it determines your ability to understand His communication. It's easy to hear someone shout across a crowded room, but if you want to hear the intimate secrets of a confidant, then you must come much closer to hear Him whisper. Jesus ministered to the multitudes, and they experienced a certain awareness of His love. The disciples who followed Christ experienced a more meaningful awareness due to their closeness with Him. Three of these disciples, Peter, James, and John, experienced even more of this intense closeness. Ultimately, John, the disciple who leaned on Jesus at the Last Supper, received the greatest revelation, which we know as Revelation, the last book of the Bible. When you lean on Jesus, expect to be amazed at what will happen. Your pursuit of Jesus will unveil the unknown and produce greater wisdom. The Holy Spirit will reveal Christ's presence in cathedrals and crawl spaces, forests and factories, schools and skate parks, kitchens and cubicles, in the brightest sunrise and the darkest night. The closer you grow in love with the Lord, the more you begin to know what He would do in any situation. It's no different from a son or daughter coming to understand how their parents make decisions and discern directions. The wisdom of God allows those who are prophetic to mature and move forward into His will for their lives. You are invited on this path of understanding. In this book, I want to share what I've learned about hearing the voice of God and encountering His presence in the world around us. You will learn to speak this spiritual language of longing. You will also begin to see how God has moved in your past without you even knowing it. Your interpretation of your life as seen through His loving presence can now direct your tomorrows and reveal answers to questions like these you've been afraid to ask yourself. Why am I here? What's my purpose in life? What story is my life telling? How is God revealing Himself and His character through the twists and turns of my faith journey? How do I position myself to move in the direction He has always been taking me? Finding these answers requires solving the puzzle that displays your prophetic life map. This is the map you are called to follow, the puzzle you long to piece together. But you have to be willing to see the pieces of the puzzle clearly. Your life can have greater meaning when you pause and look at your wounds, mistakes, choices, gifts, triumphs, and trials through the eyes of the Holy Spirit. Then you can see the pattern being formed even from your life's most painful moments. You become prophetic, fluent in the language of heaven, able to hear God's voice and celebrate His gifts as you share them with others. Jesus spoke this language because He Himself is the Word made flesh, John chapter 1, verse 14. As the ultimate translator of God's grace, He proclaimed, "I absolutely know who I am, where I've come from, and where I'm going." John chapter 8, verse 14, TPT. The more you follow Him, the more fluent you become in knowing and living out your own identity, your purpose, and your destination. There's nothing scary or crazy about this process. Knowing God is like discovering a treasure map. Being a prophetic person simply means loving Jesus so deeply that you become attuned to His presence within you. Like someone who knows what their beloved is thinking without saying a word, you become fluent in the language of His love, able to read the prophetic life map unfolding around you. Every map has a legend in which symbols are identified, sites are indicated, distances are determined, and the scale is revealed. This book is your key to reading the treasure map that God has given you. If you love the Lord and want to know Him more intimately, it's time to read your map and take giant strides on your journey. Ready to take the first step? Then let's get started. Chapter 1. Map Making, Partnering with God. Your kingdom come, Your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Luke chapter 11, verse 2. If God is your partner, make your plans big. D.L. Moody. Partnering with God often leads us to unexpected destinations. Just ask astronaut Buzz Aldrin, the second man to walk on the moon. After he and Neil Armstrong landed in the Sea of Tranquility on July 20, 1969, Aldrin prepared to take communion on the moon. He had met with his pastor, Dean Woodruff, who had blessed the bread and wine accompanying Aldrin, along with a tiny silver chalice. At the time, NASA resisted disclosing Aldrin's communion service due to an ongoing legal battle sparked by a reading from Genesis by the crew of Apollo 8 while orbiting the moon the previous year, 1968. Consequently, a radio blackout permitted Aldrin time to take a step in new spiritual territory, literally. He later wrote of his experience, "In the radio blackout, I opened the little plastic packages which contained bread and wine. I poured the wine into the chalice our church had given me. In the 1/6 gravity of the moon, the wine curled slowly and gracefully up the side of the cup. It was interesting to think that the very first liquid ever poured on the moon and the first food eaten there were communion elements. And so, just before I partook of the elements, I read the words which I had chosen to indicate our trust that as man probes into space, we are in fact acting in Christ. I sensed especially strongly my unity with our church back home and with the church everywhere. I read, 'I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever remains in me and I in him will bear much fruit, for you can do nothing without me.' John chapter 15, verse 5, TEV. What a great example of boldly celebrating a divine partnership with God. The story remained under the radar, but surfaced years later as a dynamic example of one person's out-of-this-world faith. Some have even called it the first communion. All joking aside, Buzz Aldrin strengthened his...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.